Hello, everyone. I'm Pastor John Bird, Vicar John, and welcome to Vicar John Ministries' weekly worship service. And I thank you for being here. I praise the Lord for that. Before we begin, we have some announcements to make. You can find us on YouTube and Facebook under Vicar John on our website, vicarjohn.com. And at any time in the service, you can pause and play some music, which many find are very important for worship. And you can do that right on YouTube. Some suggestions this week is, "My Life is in You, Lord, More Precious Than Silver," and "Rescue the Perishing." Please do that. Push the pause button at any point you want. And also, I will direct you in just a moment to prayer time as we'll push the pause button again and you can go into your own personal prayer, which is so very, very important. And while we're talking about prayer, and I'll bring this up again, but we should be praying for this coronavirus that's going around. It's got people scared, and it is a serious disease, but it's just something that we have to deal with. Take it to Jesus in prayer, and hopefully we don't have to get it, but if we do, ask Jesus for his healing power during this time. So anyway, just use common sense for all of this that's going around. Anyway, today's title is Your Anger Righteous? Whoa, what is that all about? We'll find out in a minute. Our number six in our 10 more wise sayings is, we are called to be witnesses, not lawyers or judges. So remember that as you go about your world. And now we'll just have our ringing in the hour of worship. And let us open with a word of prayer. Oh, gracious Lord, we thank you and praise you so much for all that you do and all that you give us, Lord. And we just ask you put the Holy Spirit upon us as we come now to worship you and only you. And we ask that if there's any bad spirits, just cast them out, Lord. We just thank you and praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our Proverbs today comes from Proverbs 15, verse 9. The Lord detests the way of the wicked, but he loves those who pursue righteousness. Praise the Lord for that too, Lord. We just thank you. And now we have our call to worship, which comes from Psalm 19. How can I know all the sins lurking in my heart? Cleanse me from all these hidden faults. Keep me from deliberate sin. Don't let them control me. Then I will be free of guilt and innocent of great sin. May the words of my mouth and the thoughts of my heart be pleasing to you, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Very, very wise words. And now we come to our time of prayer, and as I said, we should be praying for the coronavirus people and what's going on there. And in just a second, we'll have call you to your own personal time of prayer. So let's begin with just praying with me. Oh, all-knowing, all-seeing, and all-loving God, who made us in the image of yourself, we ask for your help. To help us to control our emotions in this topsy-turvy world of conflict and of strife and of disease. We ask that you help us to anchor in your Son, Jesus Christ, as we pray in his name. Now we come to you in a moment of silent prayer. Please push the pause button and go into your time of silent prayer. Oh, gracious Lord, all-loving, all-knowing, we just thank you and praise you, Lord, for all the things you give us, Lord, and we just ask today for an extra portion of self-control, Lord. Help us to give, during these uncertain times, just give us self-control, Lord, of what we're doing, where we're going, what we're doing, just everything, Lord. Just help us to be have self-control, Lord, that we don't get caught up in the things, especially of this coronavirus, Lord. There's so many false reports going out, Lord, that we need this and we need this and this is going to happen. Lord, just give us an inner calm about this whole thing, Lord, and help us to face these things with your love and with your healing power. Help us to look ahead with you. And we just thank you. We're able to do this, Lord. Lord, this week we would like to hold up people to you. We'd like to hold up the hurting and the poor throughout the world, those throughout the world who have this virus, Lord. Just put your healing touch on them. Bring them back to health, Lord. We also ask that you be with our troops wherever they may be. We ask that you be with our leaders, Lord, as they seem to have gone off the rails, so to speak, Lord. You know what I mean on this, Lord. We just help them to get back and help them to look to you, Lord. We also ask that you help be with our communities, Lord, as we are having not only a virus coming along, but we have a change of seasons, Lord, coming as spring is heading our way. And just be with us and help bring us back next week again, Lord, in one piece and healthy, Lord. We just thank you, Lord, because everywhere we look, even in the midst of strife, we see stories of your love everywhere, Lord. And we just thank you for that, Lord, and praise you that you are always there. As we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our scripture reading today comes from the book of John, chapter 2, verses 13 through 22. When it was almost time for the Jewish Passover, Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple courts, he found men selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and others sitting at tables exchanging money. So he made a whip out of cords and drove them all from the temple area, both sheep and cattle. He scattered the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. To those who sold doves, he said, "Get these out of here. How dare you turn my father's house into a market?" His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." Then the Jews demanded of him, "What miraculous sign can you show us to prove your authority to do all this?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and I will raise it again in 3 days." The Jews replied, "It has taken us 46 years to build this temple, and you are going to raise it in 3 days?" But the temple he had spoken about was his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples recalled what he had said. Then they believed the scripture and the words that Jesus had spoken. Now while he was in Jerusalem at the Passover feast, many people saw the miraculous signs he was doing and believed in his name. But Jesus would not entrust himself to them, for he knew all men. He did not need man's testimony about man, for he knew what was in a man. Thank the words of God for the people of God, and all God's people would say, praise be to God. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, we thank you again, Lord, and we just ask that the words of my mouth be your words, and they come, fall upon open ears and minds, and especially open hearts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I hope that you will notice, as we look at the passage from the book of John this week, that this is much easier reading and understanding than the instructions that we had last week from Paul in Romans. This is why I would always recommend that if you're a new Christian and want to read the Bible, then you should start in the book of John. John is easy reading, and it's a perfect place to start for the beginner. At the same time, however, it's also a great book for the more mature Christian, because it's very complex at the same time. It has been the source of much controversy over the centuries, but it remains one of the best books of the Bible. Today we are going to look at some of the issues that Jesus had with the temple and see if we might find some of these same issues in our own lives. I would like to begin today by asking the question, what really gets your dander up, or what gets you worked up into anger? We are just beginning another election season, and I find that people really get angry at the Democrats, while others get angry at the Republicans. This shouldn't be. I'm old enough to have lived at a time where there wasn't anger like this. I find a lot of people very angry at our government for allowing things to happen, and mainly it's due to a government that hasn't really done much in the last few years. Still, others get worked up if their vehicle gets dirty or their home is a little messy. It seems that sometimes it doesn't take too much to get us going. And you can include me in this also. We have a hard, sometimes have a hard time being nice to other people. Emily Post was a writer who wrote about etiquette and manners. In a world where we seem to have forgotten all manners, these might be some wise words for us. She wrote, "Manners are a sensitive awareness of the feelings of others. They are a sensitive awareness of the feelings of others." This is something that's not really taught to our young so much anymore, and it shows in the anger and defiance in this country. Today we're going to look, we see that Jesus is going to the temple during Passover. During Passover, Jerusalem was a very crowded place. Some experts say at this time the population grew to over 1 million people. Another thing to notice here is that John puts this incident at the beginning of his book, while the other Gospels, three Gospel writers, put it at the end during Holy Week. Most believe that it happened during Holy Week. And John puts it here to show everyone just how displeased God is with the people. He is using a contrast here as the scene right before this was a beautiful wedding scene at Canaan. And one thing we have to remember when we are reading John is that he was telling the story so that people would come to know Jesus. He never ever set out to tell the history of Jesus. That is why his chronological order might be a little bit off. Everything happens that he talks about, it just might not have happened in the order that he put it. In the first part of this passage, we have Jesus coming to the temple to find that people are selling animals and exchanging money inside the temple. At this time, there would have been, this week, there would have been thousands of animal sacrifices every day. It would be very hard to bring your own animal for this unless, of course, you live close by. So people would come and buy their animals for the sacrifice. And if you did bring your own animal, then it would have to be judged to be without blemish. Those people who judged the animals were in league with the sellers, so they would reject just about all homegrown stock. Then they would have to turn around and buy from their stock. There was corruption then and now. Also, people coming to Passover came from far and near. In those days, there was no real standard for money, even though the Roman money was used for taxes. So there would be all kinds of different kinds of money coming in, and the only money that was accepted here was Roman money. Therefore, the money had to be changed by the money changers, of course. And of course, they would tack on a fee for doing this so that they too could get rich. And this is what the people were doing in the temple. These things were necessary, but in the far past, they were done outside the temple, and maybe, I don't know, maybe a little more honestly. Now they are being done inside the temple. This would not have been the right thing to do then or now. I would like to draw a little attention to ourselves here as a society. A few years ago, I had a chance to go and visit one of the largest United Methodist churches in the country. You wouldn't believe this place. It was a campus, not just a church. There were separate buildings for different activities and parking lots all over the place. We went to a service on Saturday night, so it wasn't quite so crowded. From what they tell me, it was filled several times on Sunday. One of the things that I saw that seemed a little disturbing was that they had a huge bookstore right outside their sanctuary, and beside that, a coffee shop. So the question becomes, is this right or is this wrong? I'm sure that they were making profits from these items, and I'm also just as sure that they would justify it by saying that the profits went back into the church. But I couldn't help think, is this really any different than our scripture today? We have all kinds of things going on in our churches around the country, but we also have we also have another breed of what I would call a rat that sends out all kinds of ads to pastors and churches to buy this or buy that. You wouldn't believe the different money-saving and time-saving devices that they try to sell me just about every week. If I were to believe all that they tell me, I wouldn't even have to come to church on Sunday because the place would be too full. You also wouldn't believe the price tags they have on this stuff. They're very expensive. They are trying to make a killing on us who, for the most part, don't get paid that much. I'm sure you can think of ways that money has crept into our sanctuaries across the country and replaced Jesus. If we are to look closely at our television evangelists, I think that we might find that most of them live a pretty lavish life. And it all comes from them asking for $10 and keeping $5 and using $5 for ministry. I really think that when we give to a church, we should expect that the money will be used for that church and its ministries and not to line the staff's pockets. Maybe it's time we drove the money changers out of our churches today. So Jesus went ahead and drove these people and animals from the temple. Jesus was angry. He was angry at what they had done to the church. His was a righteous anger, the kind that comes when someone insults our God or the church. Under normal circumstances, we are not to be angry at each other. And if Jesus were not in the temple at this time, I think he might have reacted a little differently. But he is in God's house, and he will not tolerate lying and cheating and just plain sinning in the church. And of course, the disciples, see this, and I'm sure they're thinking that this is really totally out of character until they remember the passage in Psalm 69 where it says that this would happen. I think it's really great about all the stuff that's mapped out centuries beforehand by our God who loves us beyond measurement. It's there. Now the Jews demand, on what authority does Jesus have to do something like this in the temple? And Jesus doesn't really answer them, but he replies, "Destroy this temple, and I will raise it again in 3 days." Once again, we have people talking on different levels. The Jews were talking about the physical temple, and Jesus is talking about his body that would be resurrected 3 days after his crucifixion. Then Jesus goes on to do many miracles during the week, and many came to believe in him. But he was not fooled by them because he could see into their hearts, and he knew that many would betray him. He also knew that many only believed in the miracles that he was doing, and they didn't have a clue who he was or why he was even there. Please remember, the anger that Jesus had here didn't really result in any harm or injury. I would imagine that the Jews of the temple were furious about this, but Jesus talked with them in a very civil matter just shortly after the clearing the area. He had a righteous anger that came and went and did not harm anyone. He only shut down a very sinful business. He didn't talk down to anyone or do any of the things we normally associate with our anger. He only cleansed the church. That's all he did. In other words, he gave out his anger in love. And this is very hard for us to do. Jesus is showing us how to be angry in this passage. We are allowed to keep our anger as long as it doesn't hurt anyone. I've always enjoyed working with our youth group when we were leading a church, and one night I asked them how they dealt with anger, and they had a variety of great answers about how they would diffuse their anger. One said that she would write a letter to the person and then she would not send it. Another said she would hit a pillow. And still another said she would talk to herself when she was alone. These are all good ways to deal with anger and frustration. Then I told them to really think about it, okay? They came up with taking our anger to Jesus, of course. And I told them that when I take my anger to Jesus, I always come away feeling much calmer. He has never failed me in my anger. This might be a lesson to all of us. Most of us have to deal with anger situations at some point in our lives. I know of people, and I'm one of them, that when people get angry all around me, I want to just shrivel up and go away. I don't like anger. It gives me the shivers. I would guess that might be the case for many people. But then again, on the other hand, there are times when I get angry. Even though I hate to be around anger, I still do it myself sometimes. Or maybe some of us have a problem with anger that flares up every once in a while or quite often or even on a daily basis. This is a kind of anger that's very destructive and usually leads people to lives that are rather lonely. After all, if most of us hate to be around people who are angry, then if you are angry all the time, no one will be there. No one will want to be around you. It is these types of angers that we need to take to Jesus, and He will help you to get rid of them. We only need to ask. All you ever have to do is ask Jesus. There isn't a person here today that's watching that Jesus doesn't love. And when He loves you, He will help you if you just ask. We also want to take a look at the anger that's okay to have. It's okay to be angry sometimes. Because someone is playing bingo or gambling in the church. There are churches around that do this. It is also okay to be angry at some of the guest speakers that travel around the country, claiming to be spreading the gospel message, but they are, in fact, charging fees that are way, way too large. In other words, they're making their fortune on our backs. We can be upset when we hear about national evangelists who are taking their parishioners' tithes and living high off the hog. We can be angry about such things, and we can voice our disapproval. But beware just how you do it. You can only do it in a way that's respectful of what Jesus has taught us. You need to learn to tell people the truth in such a way that you can also extend them grace at the same time. This is a fine line that you need to find and then walk it. I praise the Lord that we have Jesus, who is always there to help us along this very stormy road. There's a story from Pat Cook about a man who went into his local Christian bookstore. He was browsing when he happened across a cap with the letters WWJD on it. You remember those? He asked the clerk what this meant, and the clerk jumped at the opportunity to make a sale and rather enthusiastically said it meant, "What would Jesus do?" WWJD. The man thought about this for a minute, and then he said, "Well, I'm pretty sure I know what he wouldn't do. He wouldn't pay $20.95 for this cap." We need to be aware of the scoundrels around us. We need to point out the truth like this man did with the cap. But we have to be careful that we don't hurt anyone in the process. This is what Jesus did at the temple as He cleansed it. There's a whole other sermon here on cleansing, okay? And maybe we'll do that next time we come across this passage. But today we will learn how to control our anger and that sometimes anger is okay. If there's anyone in the world who had a right to be angry, it was Jesus. He was a totally innocent man who was being totally rejected by the very ones that He made. He was put on trial and convicted by the ones He loved so much. He was beaten and spit upon. He was hauled out and hung upon a cross where He died. And he did this without any anger. Jesus Christ is our role model on how to control anger and how to live our lives in a way that will be most gratifying to us and to Him. He shows us the only way to true happiness is through love, not hate. If you look around, you will see the love He has wherever you look. It is everywhere. He loves you so much that He did all of this for you. Let's try to love him back in the same way. Thank you, Jesus, for this unconditional love, and thank you for first loving us. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, we thank you so much for all that you give us, and we just ask today that you help us with our anger and our anxiety and these types of things, Lord. Help us to come to you and ask for help, Lord. Ask for help and how to calm down, how to not be angry, Lord. And you will help us. We know this. We just thank you. We just have to ask. So help us to ask you. We praise you and we love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. This concludes our service for today. Please try to stay healthy the next week, and we'll see you next week again. And I thank you for being here. And now for the benediction. May the Lord bless you, and may the Lord keep you, and may his face shine upon you as you go out into this wonderful world that he made just for you, spreading his great joy. Go in God's peace. Thank you, and amen.